Hey, this is Russ Schlecht, and I'm the senior pastor of Eastside Church, and this is our podcast. I want to thank you for joining us today. I hope this inspires you, hope it builds your faith, and I hope it gives you perspective on how God is moving in your life. Enjoy the message.
The ultimate gift? This has nothing to do with that. All right. Matthew chapter 2, if you want to turn there. Jesus was born in Bethlehem during the time of King Herod, and we have this image of wise men going to visit him. Wise men going to visit him. And how many of you heard the song, "We Three Kings of Orient Are"? You know the song, right? And we kind of base our knowledge on this story based on that song. And the song is completely wrong. It's totally wrong, right? So we're going to do a little bit of historical revision this morning, get going on it. And we're going to talk about the ultimate gift and the three gifts that these wise men bring. And then we'll do some correction on it to start with, and then we're going to talk about the gifts and how they lead us to talk about the ultimate gift in Christ, all right? So let's begin. Jesus is born in Bethlehem during the reign of King Herod, and we have these wise men traveling to worship the one who is born King of the Jews. So let's begin in Matthew chapter 2, and we'll just read verses 10 and 11 right now out of the New Living Translation. It'll be on the screen. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother. Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So why is this story included in Matthew? And it's not included in any of the other Gospels. Well, Matthew leans more toward the historian in himself. So he's going to include things like the genealogy, where Jesus comes from in the bloodline. And he's going to include this story more of a historical context because he cares about this stuff. It's seemingly more than the other gospel writers. So we're going to lean toward Matthew a bit this morning. We're going to cover some of the technical stuff first. And this is important to me because I've got some hurdles to overcome with this story. Maybe you do too. Before I can get into the wise man story, I've got some hurdles to overcome because of how I understand the story to begin with. Like when you say they followed a star, you tell me that stars are moving across the sky? There were no satellites back then, so what were they following exactly? So I've got some hurdles to overcome in this story, and prayerfully for you, as we clear some things up this morning, you'll be able to dive right in as well if this is a hang-up for you. So we three kings of Orient are, they were not kings. It doesn't say that in the Bible. They were not kings. They were called magi, or wise men, astrologers maybe. And at the nativity scene, how many of you have a nativity scene at home? These are great. Anybody been to Jerusalem and you cross over into Bethlehem? Anybody been a tour? You go over to Bethlehem and you go to the wood carving places, right? And you got to buy the nativity scene, right? And they have some in there that have $5,000 nativity scenes you can buy, and it's hard not to leave those places without a nativity scene from Bethlehem. It's hard. Sometimes you can get out of there without one, but they're beautiful. We all have nativity scenes at home, and how many wise men are in your nativity scenes? Three. But does it say there are three wise men in the Bible? It does not. It just says there are magi. They present three gifts. So traditionally, we believe there were three, but it doesn't say there were three. It just says there were three gifts, so that's where we get the three, but there are no three. We give these traditional names, Malachor, Gaspar, Balthazar, but that's all tradition. That's not in the Bible, so we don't believe there were three. There could have been 10. Could have been just a bunch traveling, but they presented at least three gifts, okay? So we have the three gifts. Now, how old is Jesus when they get there? Does it say he's still in the manger when they get there? Is he in the manger? No, he's not. It says he's in a house when they get there. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother. So he's not in the manger. So he's older when they arrive. So he's in a house. So this is a bit later than the manger. And so all these ideas that we have with our nativity scene are kind of blown up a little bit. It's okay. Don't throw your nativity scene away when you get home. I'm going to keep mine. And now you're wondering if I'm going to tell you next there's no Santa Claus. That's another sermon. I'm not going to tell you that. I'm not here to tell you that. Don't worry. Now you may be thinking, is this all a legend? Is this all legend then? Well, no, it's not. here are a few things to consider if you're leaning toward this as a legend. Number one, most historians point out that no Christian writer, especially one writing toward a Jewish audience, would have made this story up. Why? Because there would be red flags all over the place. You wouldn't put magi in a Christian story. You wouldn't include astrology in a Christian story. You wouldn't highlight the merits of astrology in a Christian story, especially writing to a Jewish audience. Number two, here's what we know about astrology in ancient times. Did you know that when Julius Caesar was being buried, that a supernova appeared? Did you know that? When Julius Caesar was being buried, a supernova appeared. This was really good for business for astrologers. Because they could just say, well, whenever a bigwig would die, there's going to be a celestial event, so prepare yourselves. But when Julius Caesar died, a supernova appeared. And on this year, at this particular event, when Jesus was being born, we know that Jupiter and Saturn came together in such a way that it appeared like a star. This happened on May the 29th, October 3rd, and December 4th of that year. May the 29th, October 3rd, and December 4th, Jupiter and Saturn came together, and it made it look like a star. Number four, there was a major rumor that a great king would be born from Judea. This was not just a Jewish rumor. This was a secular rumor. It was written about by Suetonius, Tacitus, and Josephus. All non-Jews had written about this. So this rumor was circulating among non-Jews that a great king would come from Judea. So you put this all together for these astrologers or wise men, and basically on May 29, you have a stellar event that occurs where Jupiter and Saturn overlap one another. You have a rumor that a great king would be born in Judea. You have the stellar event, and you've got the wise men heading toward Judea to find out who this great king would be. And that's what they do. They go to Herod the king and say, where's this king that we may worship him? Now, did the star move? It doesn't say that in the Bible. It doesn't say the star moved. It just says there was a star, and they just go to Judea. We're here. Where's this king at? He's supposed to be here. And Herod's like, what? Oh, when you find him, let me know so I can worship him too. Or kill him. Great, we will. And then the event happens again. And so they head out. Now, why include this particular story in the Bible? There's a verse in the book of John that says it would take books and books to contain everything that happened in Jesus' life. So the gospel writers are obviously selective in what they include in the scriptures. They're selective. So everything they put in the scriptures has a reason. They're trying to communicate some kind of message to us. It has merit to it. Why this story? And why detail the gifts that were given, the gold, the myrrh, the frankincense? Well, we believe these are all symbolic of who Jesus is. They're useful. Very useful. Gold's useful. Myrrh's useful. Frankincense is useful. But they're also symbolic. Gold is symbolic of his kingship. Jesus as king. Myrrh, symbolic of the suffering servant, the Lamb of God, used for embalming. His death. And frankincense, symbolic of his royalty, his holiness. Symbolic of the prayers, symbolic of the incense burned in the Holy of Holies by the high priest as it would go up before the Lord, symbolic of Jesus, our high priest. That's why these are included. So today we're going to talk about frankincense. Let's begin there. That'd be okay? Let's talk about Jesus, our high priest. Frankincense, according to my essential oil advisors, is the Swiss Army knife of essential oils. I don't know if you're into witchcraft as well as our other essential oil people. I'm joking, it's not witchcraft. I'm joking, my wife's big into essential oils. But some people are way big into essential oils. I broke my arm, put some essential oils on it. It'll pop the bone back into place. Just kidding. Frankincense possesses antiseptic, astringent, carminative. No idea what that is. Diuretic, digestive, sedative, uterine. No idea. Vulinary and therapeutic properties. This has just been looked up. I have no idea what any of these words really mean. Antiseptic, I get. Astringent, I get. No idea what the rest of them are. Diuretic, I get. Sedative, get. Rest of them, no clue. You essential oils people, you know exactly what that means because you use that to convince us to dump those things on ourselves. But basically, frankincense is a Swiss Army knife of essential oils. I think it's really expensive too, right? Isn't like double all the other essential oils or triple? Yeah, because you can use it for everything, right? Drink it and you'll get healed, all this stuff. But back in the day, it was very expensive. It's a practical gift. It helped with sickness and wounds. So it was very practical. Here's frankincense. Mary, you can obviously use this. But it had another meaning. It was spiritual. The priests burned it. It was a fragrant offering to God. It symbolized the prayers of the saints as smoked, the prayers of the people as smoke rose to the heavens. And what Bible scholars believe is that this symbolized the priestly nature of Jesus, Jesus our high priest. Now, unless you were raised in the church or have heard this term a lot, you might not understand what it means to be a high, Jesus as our priest, our high priest. What this basically means is that Jesus represents us before God. And to put that in context, this goes back to the Old Testament and the function of the high priest for the people. And this goes back to the beginning when sin enters the world. Sin enters the world and you have this immediate conflict between the sinfulness of mankind and the holiness of God. So let's begin with the holiness of God. When we talk about the holiness of God, we're talking about God being completely set apart, transcendent, separate, perfect, flawless, and pure. When we say God is holy, we're saying that he's transcendent, that he's separate, he's perfect, he's flawless, and pure. We're not saying that God's holiness is an attribute of his. We're saying that it's perfection in all of his attributes. Every attribute that God has, he's perfect in all of them. So his power is holy. His justice is holy. His mercy is holy. And his holiness makes him worthy of our praise. So he is holy. And as we sin, as mankind brings sin into the world, we become unholy. We've separated ourselves from him. By separating ourselves from him, there needs to be this replacement, this gap needs to be filled between us and God creates this system for this gap to be filled, a sacrificial system, from the moment Adam and Eve sinned. So these two opposing forces, the holiness of God and the sinfulness of man, can be brought together. God is holy and perfect, we are not. It says in the Bible, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that the wages of sin is death, that God hates sin. Sin might not be a popular topic during an Advent or Christmas series, but you know what I'm talking about. You can feel it in you. You can feel it when other people do it to you, when you're betrayed, when wrong is done to you, when you're deceived by someone you love, when you step out of line, when you experiment with something you shouldn't be doing, when you're critical or judgmental, or you gossip about somebody, you lose your temper. I was on the flight home Friday night with the family, and I'm in the row behind Anna Maria and Joey and Annie. Julia's behind me. We're in the center section, so I've got Evie, Rosie, and Clara. And we're about 4 hours into the flight, and Evie literally has been yelling for, I'm going to say conservatively, 3.5 of those 4 hours so far, right here, just yelling. I mean, she's got Down syndrome and autism. She doesn't like flying. She doesn't like being restrained. And on a flight like that, you have to buckle her down, and she doesn't wear a mask. She won't wear a mask because she's 5 years old. She refuses to wear a mask. And on Delta or any airline right now, anyone over 2 years old, you have to wear a mask. She just keeps pulling it off, so we just don't even bother. And you can't let her run up and down the aisles without a mask on. So you strap her in, and then after an hour of that, you just let her out, and then she wants to get out, and you can't get her out, so you just hold her and keep her in. Well, she's super strong. She's 55 pounds. So I'm not whining. I'm just saying this is it, right? So your phone, movies, cookies, you know, potato chips, all the rules have been broken at this point. Like, you're just anything you can do. I mean, a stun gun, I mean, you name it, trying all of it. And I have set my controls on my TV screen to moderate, so all the good movies have been taken away on my screen. And I can't unset it unless I get a flight attendant to help me. So I'm really mad. And I don't want to call a flight attendant over. They're already mad at me because my kid is just going nuts, right? So I'm like, I can only watch like PG movies, not even PG-13. I'm telling on myself, right? Doesn't matter. I'm not watching a movie anyway. So I'm going to watch E.T. I want to watch E.T. Start E.T. And Evie's nuts. So I literally put the ear pods in my ears for 5 minutes. All I want is 5 minutes of E.T. And it's the scene where E.T. is just out in the shed outside, and Elliot is throwing the ball into the shed, and the ball is coming, baseball's coming back out. And I love E.T. It's like my childhood, right? And Evie's yelling, and I put on the Wiggles for her, and I turn it up on my phone so she can hear it. It's a little loud, but I don't really care. And so I'm here, and I get my earbuds in, and Anna's in the seat in front of me, and Anna turns around and starts waving her hand in front of my screen. The nerve. This is the first time I've been able to watch anything in 4 hours. You know what I said? I go, what? Like that. And she goes, and turns around. And I was like, well, I told her, she ain't gonna turn around again. And that lasted about 0.1 millisecond. And then it was just like, what in the world, man? You got issues, bro. So ear pods out, you know, E.T. is gone, and I, you know, and she's like, your phone is really loud. You're disturbing like a 4-row radius with the Wiggles. And I was like, okay, so turn it down. And she sits up, and I go, I'm sorry, I snapped. And she's like, it's okay. And I'd agree to take Evie this flight, because she took Evie the last flight there, the red eye, and she screamed all the way on the red eye. So I was just earning my spot in the marriage, basically. And she turned around and forgave me. But I mean, just that split second of yelling at her, you know? But you know it. You know when you cross the line. You know when you flare up and you're like, me. You know that. And that's nothing. I mean, we've been in way worse fights than that. That's a baby fight compared to the real stuff, right? You know when the me monster comes out, you lose your temper. You know what sin feels like. And that conviction comes in. You see the hurt in somebody's eyes. I don't have to explain sin. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. And the wages of this sin, because of the holiness of God and his perfection, leads to our complete separation from him. Without some sort of mediation, without atonement in the middle of it. So God sets up this system for us. Here's a quote. If we don't understand the holiness of God, we will always have this casual approach to sin. Greg Rochelle said that. If we don't understand the holiness of God, we'll always have a casual approach to sin. And what helps me with that is when I'm thinking about, you know, sin and its impact on other people, or sin and its impact on the Lord, is these people that I'm sinning against or against him, these people belong to him, you know? Think about Anna Maria, like that's his daughter. I know it's Camilo and Gladys's daughter, but it's also God's daughter. Like I'm yelling at God's daughter, right? She belongs to him, and I'm yelling at her. Casual approach. No big deal. It is a big deal. So the priest once a year would go into the Holy of Holies, this inner part of the temple, and offer a sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. This is what the high priest would do. He would sacrifice an innocent animal behind this veil in the tabernacle, the Holy of Holies. He'd burn incense, frankincense, representing the prayer of the people. He'd sprinkle the blood of this animal on the mercy seat. An animal would die in place of the people, an innocent animal. It was a gross system. It was unfair. It was extreme. It was the killing of innocent animals. It was bizarre. But all I can say is this, because God is just, he has to punish sin. He has to make amends for it. But he's not only just, he's also merciful, because he does bring his people back. He doesn't just allow them to stay in their sin. He buys them back. He atones for them. The sacrifice satisfies God's justice at the same time, extends mercy to them. He doesn't just leave me in my seat. But this was all temporary. This was all old covenant, the old arrangement. But we're not under the old arrangement anymore. We're under something now called the new covenant. So Hebrews 10 explains this. Hebrews 10, 10 through 12. For God's will was for us to be made holy. Now, all the things we just said about holiness, about God, his holiness, God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ. Once for all time, under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins, can't take them away completely. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. I'm going to read it again, and I think that's worthy of a hand clap, okay? So, but our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Can we say amen to that? Good for all time? It's forever. Our sins are atoned for forever. So Jesus, the high priest, paid for our sins, not a temporary covering, but permanent removal of our sins. So I'm just going to lead us in two steps this morning before we go. And one of them is this. Imagine yourself in place of the Magi. And the stars appeared again, the two planets aligned, and the star, quote, has appeared again. And you go to the house, and you present your gifts. You bow down, it says. It says they bowed down. You present your gifts. It's you now. You're the gift. And as you present yourself with your offering, I would just say this, you come humbly. Number one is to come humbly before the King. Come humbly. Now, the Savior we worship is not distant. He's a high priest who cares and understands us. Hebrews 4, verse 14 says this, so then we have a great high priest who's entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses. For he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. This high priest is not some distant God on a throne. He understands all our weaknesses, relates to the trials we have. He sympathizes with the pain that you carry. That's this Jesus. He understands what you're going through at this very moment, right now, in your life. The craziness of your life, the stress you're carrying, your messed up family. Think about his story. Conceived out of wedlock to a teenage mom. Growing up in a small town. You can imagine him referred to as the bastard boy in his town over and over and over again. lived in poverty, criticized, ridiculed, bullied, tempted over and over again by the devil, attacking him when he was most vulnerable, had a close friend die, grieved the loss of family members, accused of things he didn't do, his best friends betrayed him, worst of all, felt abandoned and deserted by God himself. Why have you forsaken me? He's felt like you feel. He understands you. What you feel, he felt. Where you hurt, he hurt. He's not sitting in heaven saying it stinks to be you. He's a high priest who understands. So Hebrews 4, 14 through 16. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy. And we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Let us come boldly to the throne. So we come humbly, but we don't have to cower. We approach as children, but with confidence and assurance because we're loved and we're welcome. My kids don't hesitate to crawl in my lap. My kids all know that each one of them is my favorite. My kids don't hesitate to ask me for things because they know I will do my best to give it to them if I am able and I think it's in their best interest. And sometimes when it's not, I'll still give it to them because I love them and I want them to be happy. They don't hesitate. So number two, Magi, as you bow. One, come humbly, but second, come boldly before the throne of your gracious God to receive his mercy and find help when you need it most. Amen? So let us approach right now. So why don't you prepare yourselves? You can bow your heads, you can kneel if you want to, but imagine yourself as the wise men, the wise women approaching the throne. Joya, would you join me up here? And whoever on your team is going to join you for that last song, that would be great. You may be approaching this morning and you've got someone else on your mind besides yourself that you want to bring to the Lord, or a particular need in your life that you're bringing to him. Maybe you're struggling financially this morning. Jesus is your provider. You're hurting emotionally. Jesus is your comforter this morning. Struggling physically, Jesus is your healer this morning. You've got a loved one far from God. Jesus is their Savior this morning. Maybe you're tired and exhausted. Where you are weak, he is strong. Maybe you're battling anxiety or depression this morning. Jesus is your Prince of Peace this morning. Let us approach the throne of grace boldly. Well, Jesus, we approach you this morning humbly, the Holy One of Israel, our High Priest. We bow in your presence, acknowledging our sin, acknowledging our brokenness, our humble place as human beings, and you as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We repent of wrong thinking. We repent of moving ourselves into the center of our lives. We replace ourselves with you on the throne, in your rightful place. And now, Jesus, we come boldly as well as your children. You died once and for all to cover our sin and wash them away. We receive that now. We present ourselves to you and these offerings of our lives. We yield to you. We present it. All these things we have, these weights we're carrying, the needs we have, financial, emotional, spiritual, our families, our job situations, our mental health, our marriages, Lord, our children, our parents, our friends, some we've lost over the last couple years. All of them, Lord, we present them at your feet, our high priest, and we say, Jesus, you are our everything. You are our high priest. You are our healer, our Lord, our provider, our Prince of Peace, our Savior, our source. Heal, restore, cover, provide. We trust you. We lean on you. We yield to you. We love you. We honor you. We bow before you and call you Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 Amen.